The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Thanks for joining in. Thanks for tuning in. We are up to topic three, week three. We're going to have a bit of a talk this evening, or it is evening for me, about digital communications, and which is fascinating because we're using a digital communication to do that. Before we do, we've got our interesting poll here that I'm sure some of you are looking forward to seeing what the results are. So let me go through the motion of closing the poll and sharing the results with you. So you can see that, and we'll have a little bit of a chat about what that might mean. So here we go. We're seeing here a reasonable spread of results for the first three. So nearly a quarter are saying email is a big winner or loser. Big point of frustration. Instant messaging, popular with some. A lot of people have commented on social media. That's the most significant answer here. And it was the leader, and I was watching the poll results over the last 20 minutes because we always launch this a little bit early. And I did see social media as the front runner pretty much the whole way through. So that suggests that that's a fairly strong candidate for a portion of digital media or digital communications that we could probably do better. Websites didn't feature as well as I thought they might. I was expecting a little more than 7% to comment on that. But I think perhaps it's because websites as a medium are a little more mature. The creators and users of websites are a little more familiar with how that's all meant to work. Perhaps we've got our head around that a little bit more from a professional point of view. But 14% feel that all of them are an issue. And I'm in that bottom category, 14%. I think that all of them are used in ways that they could be used far better. And hopefully we'll tap into a couple of those insights in this discussion, and hopefully some of you will add your comments and have some interesting additional things to say and add to all of that as we go through. So let me first kick off the discussion. We'll do our housekeeping. I'll launch the screen sharing here just so that we can get a look at the slides. Here we go. So the housekeeping, just so that for those of you who might be joining in for the first time or have not attended these before, the questions box in the Citrix panel, that's where you'll be putting your questions and comments, anything that you want to elaborate on. As per last week, I want to encourage anyone that just has a comment, a suggestion, an idea, something they just want to add that they'd love to elaborate on, we'll pull those out. Love to have a talk about what you think and feel about these. It's not just about questions you might want answered. It's about answers as well. So throw anything you like up in there. We have James who is behind the scenes collecting all that, looking through all that, and he'll be flagging all the ones that we have time to cover as we go through the discussion tonight. Of course, the online portal, that's where you're going to find everything. So if you're tuning in, you might have missed a previous recording, you might have missed a previous webinar, you'll find the recordings there. You'll also find the discussion forums. So there's been some interesting discussions. There's been some feedback and response to some of them. There's also, as I said, the webinar recording, so all of these get recorded and they get posted up there. There's also a YouTube link as well, so you can also stream it rather than have to download a big file. So that's the address. That's where you find all of that sort of stuff. There's also the pre-recorded audio files. Hopefully some of you have had a chance to download those and have a look through those. Gives you a bit of a starter on what we're going to talk about and what we're going to think about. Now, I do want to clarify something that I might have slightly misled you. In the first webinar discussion that we had, we talked about what we'll cover. And here's the correct version. Now, can anyone remember what it is that I had in point four, topic four there, last when I first spoke about it in week one? Can anyone remember what I had there instead of this? It's a trick question for you. We had something else. And this was not a deliberate test on my part to see whether or not our digital communications were working and whether or not you were quick enough to spot it. No, this was actually an error. We had a comment in there about talking about reporting and whatnot. So what we're going to do is we're going to give you the persuasion and buy-in topic next week, which is what we originally promised as part of the course curriculum. But we are going to add an extra recording from the proposals and reporting topic, which includes a discussion about written persuasion, how to persuade with the written word rather than in a more general context. So we'll add that extra pre-recorded audio file and that extra component to our discussion next week, just in case some of you were really looking forward to that aspect of it. So I apologize for any miscommunication. And for those of you who were completely missed it and were unaware, thanks for bearing with us with it. So tonight, digital communications. Let's start with the most pervasive, the most dynamic, email. How did we ever live without email? In the mid-1990s, I actually worked for an internet provider in Australia, one of the very first. In fact, I think they were the third internet provider in the country. And that was back in the days when email addresses were pretty cool. And we, as employees at an internet company, we went to work in T-shirts because we were pretty cool working for an internet company. And you know, we were excited when we saw somebody's business card that had an email address on it, because that's what we were trying to promote. That's what we were trying to sell and trying to do things with. These days, of course, it's so ubiquitous. We're so overloaded with email that a lot of us have gone past the point where email has become a useful, interesting tool. And it's become a bane of our existence. I know a number of people that have a lot of trouble keeping up with the enormous amount of email that they get bombarded with. And it's created this culture of rapid response to what we're doing. So this opportunity to communicate so fast and so efficiently and so effectively that at times that opportunity becomes an obligation. And when it's a failed obligation, it becomes a source of stress. It becomes a source of situational failure. We can often depend and rely upon email, but email is just a tool. It's a function that allows humans to communicate. And today, our technology is usually pretty solid. It's not email that fails. It's the people that fail. It's the sender or the recipient who perhaps could have handled that email communication more effectively. The results in the failure for outcomes. So we get information overload. I know a few friends of mine and a colleague I used to work with was terribly stressed because of the number of emails that she got every day. And there's this mental paradigm that occurs when the inbox is picking up all your emails. What happens is that you might be looking at one email, and the way that the brain processes our stress is that it says that this is the most important thing to think about right now, this one first email. But every other email in the inbox is, theoretically, the second most important thing. So what we have is this massive, enormous list of the second most important thing that we need to do because we haven't necessarily prioritized it. Now, some of you might be a little more switched on than that, and you might have prioritization with your inbox. You might be very efficient and effective at managing your inbox problem. But lots of people aren't. And this is what's led us to react to emails a little differently than we might have done perhaps 10 years ago. Now, there's some obvious things that we think about when we think about email. We know that email is just words on a page. We know that it conveys merely information. It does not necessarily convey understanding. The understanding doesn't live in the words. It doesn't live in the page. It doesn't live in the email. The understanding exists in the mind. It only exists in the mind. So if you want to create understanding, you have to create the understanding. So you have an understanding in your mind when you want to send an email. You put a translation of that into words, and the job, the purpose of those words, is to recreate a similar understanding at the other end. But within those words, it doesn't exist. So if we think about it that way, and if we agree with that logic, then email is really disempowered. It's really just something that we can use to achieve something else, but our purpose is to actually achieve that something else. So the inbox nightmare, I'm sure many of you have encountered this sort of problem. I'm sure many of you have encountered this sort of drama. Managing the inbox as a to-do list. I have a funny story, and I mean, it's funny in hindsight, but it wasn't very funny for the poor chap at the time. But I used to work with a chap many years ago who used to track his inbox and what was to be done based on whether or not he'd marked that email as having been read or not. Because those of you who are familiar with most systems, it's in bold text, right, if it's not read. And so this is how he was tracking all the stuff that he hadn't done yet. And, of course, his massive inbox was full of historical unread emails, not because he hadn't read them, but because he hadn't marked them as read, because they were something that he was meant to do something with. But for those of you who are familiar with Outlook and the keystroke shortcuts, Control Q is what you press to mark an email as read, and Control A is what you press to highlight all of your emails. So if you bump Control A on the way to Control Q, you've effectively selected all and marked them all as read. And this happened to this poor chap one day. You can imagine he didn't get a lot of sympathy. He was in fits at the time because all of his careful tracking of what he thought he was meant to do. It's just to illustrate the fact that most of us have slightly imperfect ways of handling the paradigm of inbound communications via email. There is just too much of us. So if we think of email as only a basic form of communication, there are certainly far more elaborate, far more complex. We know already most of us would be in a situation where we've sent emails that we probably should have used the phone, we probably should have made a call, we probably should have gone and met the person, maybe they're not that far away if you're sharing a work environment with them. But what affects our decision-making that has us send an email? And how do we treat others that send emails that are less than perfect? I'm just looking at a couple of comments, and there's a comment, Eric saying that, Eric says, we wrote memos which were delivered into intranets, and this encouraged greater care of communication. I think Eric's answering the question, what did we do before emails? We certainly did have memos and we had intrays, and I can remember a time when I had a phone call return slip. I had a spike on my desk, and on that spike was all of the little slips from the receptionist that had been stuck on that spike of all the phone calls I had to return whenever I come back to my desk, which was usually many. And for many of us, we lived a lot more on the phone than we do today. And it could be argued, and I think argued quite effectively, that for many of the things that we did communicate about, we achieved far more effective results because that's the environment we lived in. Now, another comment from Gaith is saying that I would say it is not the rapid response is the issue, but the unrealistic expectations on how fast a person should respond to an email, assuming people will respond based on how you do things instead of on their timeline. And I think that's a very good point. A lot of the time, we have our own personal standards of how we respond to email. We might have a certain policy ourselves. We want to respond within a certain time frame. We want to respond with a certain degree of thoroughness or however. But expecting that from other people is unrealistic. All you can expect from them is what they've taught you to expect. But usually the expectations are going to be more in line with what we need them to be in order to achieve our own objectives. If we need something back straight away, then it's likely that we're going to want to expect it. We're going to want to expect that person will choose today to be responsive with their email. And if we want to make sure, we might put something in the email that says, please let me know today. Maybe that's enough, maybe it's not. Maybe their reason for not responding to it straight away is that they don't even read it until they're ready to act upon it. So how can we elaborate on some of the specific ways in which email is a problem? And look, lots of this sort of stuff. You're going to look at this and you're going to think, yeah, of course that's the case. Of course that's my problem, or that's a little bit of my problem, etc. But we want to talk about the psychology of why it happens so that we can deconstruct the reasons for it and try and find a better way for ourselves and perhaps a better way to overcome those problems when we encounter them from people that we're communicating with via email. One of the things that we know happens with email is that it's used as a barrier. A lot of the time, and I've been guilty of this myself, you think, oh, I probably should give that person a call. But look, oh, that could drag on and I might not get in touch with them. I'll just send them an email. Why do we do that? Often we do it because we're wanting to narrow the scope of the communication. If we have a conversation, it might elaborate into other things that we don't have time for or that we feel we don't have time for. Back in the times when I used to work in the networking and communications industry, we had a famous client. I mean, he was famous to us because he could talk the leg off an iron pot. He was the kind of chap who would literally, you ring up to ask a question and you'd be on the phone for 45 minutes later. So there are sometimes valid reasons. We have these kinds of challenges in our communications, but how often do we use it inappropriately as a barrier? We hide behind email. We think, well, there's an email, this person has sent me an email. They don't quite understand. I probably should call them and explain, but I'll just send them another quick email in reply. So in this way, You can say that there are circumstances where email becomes more of a barrier. It's a reason to lower the quality of our communications, to lower the quality of our connections, than it is to improve upon them. Another aspect of email is that it's often a form of expression. We're often putting something quickly, succinctly perhaps, but we're putting it in a very present tense. A lot of the time we write what we're thinking about, and we put it in terms that come from our thoughts onto the page, and we click send, and away it's gone. Now, for those of you who've had a chance to read the PDF document that we put up, and we will elaborate on that in a little while, it's leading into that discussion. But most email is written from the perspective of the author, what's in their mind as they write it. But remember, translation is all that email can do. The understanding cannot be conveyed by email. It has to be reconstructed. So whatever you put into your email, it's not enough to simply have it an expression of your understanding. It's got to recreate someone else's understanding. What about those emails that seem to waffle on an awful lot, but actually convey very little? There was a time when I think my colleagues would have said that I was a little guilty of that. I was trying to be thorough. My view of email communication was that I'll just put that extra paragraph in just to make sure they understand. Well, sometimes that can be very counterproductive. If you have a situation where you're saying the same thing twice in an email but in a different way because you want to be thorough, you want to make your point and then make it again, you want to reiterate, but people are so used to a concise understanding of what they're reading, you run the risk of someone saying, well, they've said this here in this paragraph, and then they've said this here. They wouldn't have said the same thing twice. They must mean something a little bit different in the second statement. That's the sort of risk we run with these sorts of things. But also, it also suggests that we're not clear on what we mean. And if we're not clear, or if we don't come across as being clear on what we mean, it's a lot harder for the reader and the recipient to recreate their understanding of the confusion that we've obviously expressed. What about when we send email just that little bit too quick? We just haven't checked it enough. I've got a poll coming up in a little while at the end of the next slide. It'll ask you what you feel are the most common causes of poor emails that you receive. So you'll be able to give me your thoughts and views on all this sort of stuff shortly. But yes, those emails that clearly were underprepared. We often get those. Sometimes we get them every day. But emails that were ill-conceived, poorly thought out, not properly reviewed, and not entirely useful. And occasionally they come from us. What about those emails that are really for a topic that shouldn't have been put in writing? Things that are meant to be conveyed with a degree of content and meaning that probably should have been done via a different medium. Here's a quote that I loved from a lady by the name of Erin McKean. Now, Erin is I can't even remember the word now. She's an editor at a major dictionary. A lexicologist, I think it is. Someone might be able to correct me on that. Lexicologist, something, I think what it is, who handles lexicons and the meaning of language and symbols. Her phrase, her statement here is to say, a love letter is to be savored, but a love email is to be forwarded to all your friends and probably laughed at. So it means that the point taking from this is that there really are some things that our human relationship with the topic and the way in which we recreate our understanding of what was meant has such an emotional connection that it's undermined by the medium. Has anyone received a love email that they felt really should have been done a different way? I mean, in some ways, we might feel fortunate to have received such a thing at all. It's probably better than not getting one, I would say. But really, there are some specific things that we should be doing in specific mediums. Let's look at some of the comments and questions that are coming through as we go. What are we seeing? Navdeep is saying, I feel email is more efficient than other modes of communication. The person doesn't need to quickly switch to my topic. They can read and respond as per their priority. And it's filed for reference. So I think these are all reasons why we know and appreciate that email can be very valuable. And it can be more efficient in terms of referencing it, in terms of processing the communication over a period of time. what it really doesn't do well is confirm and convey an understanding. So in those examples, those are examples of ways in which email is very effective, provided we accept that the email is recreating an effective understanding at each time. But these are the reasons, the goody reasons, why we use it. Scott's making the comment, email takes the emotion out, which makes it hard to understand the context at time. It certainly can take the useful emotions out. It can take out inflection. It can take out tone. But then from what we've talked about in the earlier subject, and especially I think topic two, we can also inject a little bit of tone, but sometimes we can inject the wrong tone, or our tone might be perceived one way and meant another. And one of the classics is sarcasm. I mean, how many times have we misread or misstated a sarcastic comment? And especially when you look at cultural differences, some cultures revel and enjoy sarcasm as an interesting intellectual pursuit, and other cultures, they just don't adopt it. It doesn't work for them. And those cross-cultural concepts of tone and attitude within written words can be quite confusing. But certainly I agree, it takes away what you would probably call the body language of communication. That sort of thing certainly doesn't exist. David saying, finds the opposite. Not sure the opposite of what, David. I'm going to make an assumption there. We'll read on, see what David's saying. When people phone him or they use link, heaven forbid, just turn up at the desk, they're telling me that their time is more important than his time. So David's saying that, and I think this is echoing what Navdeep said a moment ago, when you use email as a communication medium, you are not triggering an interruption. You are not forcing the other person to respond to your time frame. And if you're the recipient of that, and I certainly agree with what David's saying, that it can be tragic for someone to just walk up at your desk and start talking at you rather than with you. I mean, they don't even have your attention as yet. And you might be deeply intellectually involved in something else. That's not communication. That's interruption. But what might be an effective or more effective way is to make an agreement that you're going to get together and talk about it in 10 minutes' time. And that agreement might be reached via email or via instant messaging, which we'll talk about shortly. So what I'm suggesting is that we can separate the problems that email can cause and associate them with the behavior and the way in which email is used or not used, rather than blaming it on the particular tools themselves. So in the example of someone that just rings out of the blue without checking whether or not you're available, they could have approached that differently. They could have arranged a conversation at a certain time via various means, or they could have perhaps begun the conversation by checking to see if you have the time and attention available, and if you don't, arrange another time when you do. There are ways in which those things could be done, and those are inherent to the way in which that person chooses to communicate. It's not necessarily to do with the medium of communication in the first place. Peter's just reminding us of the web, the jargon of TLDR. Too long, didn't read. Yes, I was shamefully guilty of that a number of years ago. AJ's saying, email can't let you be straight. I find it hard to say difficult things face-to-face. And this is, I think what AJ is talking about here is an example of why some things get creep into email that others would say, and perhaps the recipient would say, maybe they shouldn't be in email. Maybe that particular, but we put it there because it might be challenging for us to find a way in to doing so verbally. I know one very famous CEO, whom I won't name, but his claim, his belief is that email is eroding the natural skill set of tackling difficult subjects verbally face-to-face. His belief is that it is actually, on average, undermining the native skill sets that most of us have or did have or have underutilized that make it more effective for us to deal with those tough things verbally or face-to-face. Now, it's an interesting point. I mean, I'm not sure if I agree with that, but I think it's certainly shifting the culture towards an acceptance of that, where it's slightly more acceptable to put confronting, challenging things in an email than it used to be perhaps some time ago. So let's pull out some of the points pardon me, that were put in the out of email PDF for those of you who have read it. Here's some key points that were taken out of that. Write your email from the reader's viewpoint. Remember, you are trying to create an understanding in the other person's mind. You need to try to at least put some effort into thinking about how they're going to respond to this. What are they going to think when they read this? What are they going to read? Not what I'm going to say. What are they going to read? Keep their viewpoint, their worldview, their history, their perspective, their attitude, everything of that nature that you can know in mind. The reason we do that is because everything we put in an email is because of the result that it's meant to achieve. We're writing for the result. We're not writing to make an expressive statement, or at least usually. Sometimes we send an email to get something off our chest. But usually we're writing because something needs to happen. We need to focus on that purpose when we put anything in an email document. Write to the heart, not to the mind. What do I mean by that? Well, we can elaborate on that when we talk a bit more about the three vectors of change, which we'll touch on again in a little while. But what we're saying is that if we want something done, if we want some outcome, if we want some resolution, then there has to be a degree of meaning for the other person. If there's no meaning, then we have a more tenuous link to whatever might motivate them to do something about it, to act or perform or even reply. Qualify statements. I think when we put things that are more likely expressions in an email, then we're less likely to qualify it. Qualification of a statement can mean contextualizing it. It can mean in this situation, this might be the case. Putting parameters. What the qualification does is it shapes the context of the response. So it's meant to limit the possibility that someone will have a more aberrant reaction, where they might have a more extreme reaction, where they might come at it from a tangent and think that we meant something far more disconnected than we really did. So qualifying our statements is a way of narrowing down the scope of response and reaction, keeping the scale of it limited to what we really meant. And address secondary questions. Now, reading this, you might think, well, isn't that directly in conflict with another point that we've made elsewhere in the pre-recorded audio that says, well, look, just make it one point per email. One thread of conversation, yes. But that doesn't mean that that thread of conversation might have very closely related to it secondary questions that we perhaps should address. Not at the top, but subsequently, and clearly separated. You might make an opening statement that says, here's my point. And then to elaborate, here's a second point. And then to elaborate, here's another thing you might be thinking about. But then no need to go into too much detail, because if they have that many questions and you need to give that many answers, then maybe you just need to arrange a phone call. Or maybe you need to make the point and say, let me know if any of this is something we need to discuss. Call me if you want to discuss it. Or I'll call you to check that you understand. Peter's asking the question, what about legal ramifications of using emails being evidence in court? Well, there's been plenty of precedents in that. You've got plenty of examples of where digital communications has been used in court. It's something that we definitely need to think about. Anything that is on the letterhead, and email is considered to be on the letterhead if coming from the address of the organization, is deemed to be an official communication of that organization in many courts of law, in many countries. It does depend on where you are, but in the majority of cases and situations in a corporate environment, yes, it's considered to be admissible as evidence that you said that, and you said that as some degree of representative in your capacity for that organization. Now, I guess that was perhaps some of the early days when we began to see that email could get a little bit curly and a bit hairy and a bit of out of control. We organizations threw that in as a way of, well, look, you know, this is all legally admissible, so think about what you put in your emails. Really, I think the issue is far bigger than that. It's far more about, if you want to get a result, if you want email to do a job for you, then think more about your emails. So that's not something that's quite as easy to put in a policy document, though, for an organization. That's much more of a cultural phenomenon. Tracy's just got a comment here. In relation to writing from the reader's viewpoint, it would be very valuable to consider the person's learning style or preference, as you may never get the result that you're actually seeking. And she's put a bit of an example in there. A kinesthetic preference person may not be able to interpret email written by a person with a visual preference. And I think that's very true. And part of the problem, though, with trying to tackle that is a lot of us aren't really in a position to make that quick judgment and assessment as to the detail of their personality. So what we tend to do is we use a default. We just go to the lowest common denominator of the communication medium, and that is we spell it out in as simplistic terms as we can. It might not be aligned, but if we do know a bit about that person's point of view from the examples, as you say, a kinesis or a visually oriented person, maybe we can tailor that. I would probably think that's a bit too much to expect of most people presenting and writing emails, but it would certainly be a nice thing to be able to do if you could. Navdeep is just asking, again, give an example of writing for results, not for the statement. An example that I used to use many years ago was an example about if you're writing to a client to set up an appointment with that client, that's your result. So what you want to put in your email correspondence to that client is whatever they need to know in order to attend. And they need to know what do they do if perhaps they can't attend, or if they need to change the time, or what other information do they need? They need contingency information. They might need to know how to get there if it's a location they haven't been to before. They might need to know exactly when. They might need to know anything that's going to make it easy for them to appear at that point in time. So thinking about the result means that we might put different kinds of additional information in that correspondence, in that email, that if we were simply saying, well, we've got an appointment for you at 10:30 tomorrow in Wollongong, well, that might not be adequate, especially for those who are not sure where Wollongong is or even what country it might be in. But writing for the results means that you check to see what questions and what lack of understanding the recipient might have in order for them to achieve what you want them to achieve or what you need to accomplish out of it. So it's a focus. It's an awareness that simply saying something is not necessarily going to achieve the results. Let's pull up our poll. Here's the question. I'll throw the poll up there in a moment. Question is, what are the most common types of bad emails or poor emails that you tend to get each week or each month? Let me bring that poll up and launch it. And you can all share your views, and we'll share those. I'm going to give you a minute and a half or so, which is long enough for me to have a quick sip of my cup of tea. While we do that, has anyone got any other comments they want to throw in? I know we've covered a few. It's been some excellent thoughts and contributions, by the way. Once you've ticked your option, throw up your thoughts in there. Here's a comment from Push. Email normally archive for 5 years. So these days, think before you write anything in email. Could live forever. It's a good point. I can tell you for a fact, I've got emails that I've archived that are significantly older than 5 years. I've deleted lots, but anything I thought I needed to keep at the time, I still have. And that's probably going back 8-10 years now. I don't have it at my fingertips, but I still have it. And there'll be lots of other people out there that have been in the same situation. There's a lot of opportunity for localized archiving. So even though the company might say, well, we're only going to store it on our backups and on our server for 5 years, it may live far, far longer than that. What other comments have we got? Tracy saying, good to work in an organization that actually ascertains the learning styles of the team so that the team members could potentially improve communications on a range of levels. Tracy's saying that she did that with all of her staff and the entire work environment improved from the positive communications amongst team members. Frankly, I think that's a fantastic idea. I think that sort of responsible approach to the need for effective communications is excellent. And I would applaud any effort at any level in any way from an organization that is intent on not only taking their communications outcomes seriously, but in encouraging the mindset that everyone should take a degree of responsibility and make a higher level of effort in achieving poor communications. But you could debate the concept that the majority of problems, failures, weaknesses, limitation, challenges that a corporate professional environment faces are due to weaknesses in communication. If that is true, or even circumstantially true, then if you consider the fact that the majority of that communications for most modern organizations is electronic, then perhaps electronic and digital communications is the biggest weakness in the business world, potentially. I mean, it's a debatable point. Is there some merit in the argument? Look, I think there is. I think there is a case for saying that it is certainly, in my experience, far more significant in the long-term strategic outcomes of any organization than most organizations would give credit for, and that most individuals would give credit for. It is far more likely to be a limiting force for the individual's success in life than that individual would likely give credit for. Some would argue that it's the most important life skill that we will ever have. Again, some of these are debatable thoughts. But we've got lots of people that have voted now. Let's close this and share the results, and we can have a chat about what it might mean. Confusing language. Now, this is the third time that I've actually run this particular poll with a group of people, and every time that is the winner. It's always the top runner, using confusing or poor language. Now, if you go back to what we talked about in the last 2 weeks, I guess that's why we probably spent a bit of time on it over the last 2 weeks, because it doesn't really matter necessarily which medium you're using. If your language is good or not, and your ability to create understanding is effective or not using your language, it doesn't really matter whether it's by email or something else. What else we got? Too long and complex? Too long and complex? Sometimes I wonder if emails being too long and complex is a bit of a symptom of the fact that we have so many. If we didn't have so many, would long and complex emails be as much of an issue? I don't know. It's an open question, I guess, perhaps. Certainly, 30% suggests that regardless of that fact or not, there certainly are too many long and complex emails. Does that go back to what we've already talked about, to what some of you have mentioned, where perhaps we do occasionally hide behind emails a little bit? We send stuff out that we're hoping will create an understanding at the other end, perhaps even subconsciously knowing that it's going to struggle to do that. But our best chance is to send a perhaps overly long and complex email when really that understanding might have been better with a short email supplemented with a verbal conversation. Anthony's saying, what's Anthony? Need to have in the poll shot from the hip, written and sent too fast. Anthony would have picked that. If we'd had an option in there that sent too fast, typos or missing words, etc., that's what Anthony would have picked. I'm sure some of you, lots of others would have picked that as well. It's a good point. Maybe I should add that in next time. Maybe I should make that in the other category. Maybe that's what everyone was saying with the other category. It's an interesting point. There is obviously too much expression, not enough substance, people rambling, waffling. Sometimes that's okay. Sometimes it's too consistent. Raising more questions than they answer. I think that, you know, that sort of problem means that the email, if to solve those questions, if it needed to be long and complex, again, maybe an email wasn't the best and only method of communicating about that topic. Teresa is saying, in response to the poll, others, email that has too little information. Thanks, Teresa. Explaining what was meant there in others, too little information, too brief, too simple. I mean, some have felt it's too long and complex. Others are feeling maybe sometimes it's too brief. Naftip just commenting, most challenging emails are unfiltered forward with no actions. FYI, CC to 10 people. Just shotgun broadcast emails that just get sent out there for everybody. Absolutely. I mean, I think there's an acceptable policy that if someone is copied, CC'd on an email, that they probably would not actually read any more than the subject line on the basis that, you know, if that was really meant for them, they would have been included in the to field. And I think that's quite reasonable. Eric's just saying that... He says, I find the most common type of poor email is other, a situation identified, but the next step is not considered. The end result is that multiple emails are sent where one should suffice. So, sounds like an example of the secondary questions problem. Sounds like also a bit of what Charissa was saying, too little information. So, creating a thread of to and fro correspondence to cover things that probably could and should have been handled in the first email, maybe even via email. You know, maybe those situations, they don't need a phone call. They just need a more well thought through and more comprehensive email. Well, let's hide that and move on to the next stage of our interesting discussion. Tracy's just saying it'd be good to have a short, succinct email with an attachment, with details clearly identified. Yes, I think the whole point of supplementary information, secondary, for people to use as they need it. Well, actually, we're going to elaborate on that towards the end. We've got some points on the vectors of change that might cover that. So social media. Who doesn't love talking about social media? Now, we all know about concepts like Facebook, and I use the term Facebook here not as a derogatory term, but it's a friend of mine used this fairly recently. The point he was making is that if something is somewhat farcical in nature, if it's somewhat bizarre, somewhat surreal in nature, then it's more likely to end up being expressed and viewed and followed by more people. We have this inherent fascination with something that is radically outside of our normal world existence. And it could be a little bit weird, it could be eccentric, it could be strange, or it could be positive, it could be fascinating, it could be those cute things. Now, most of us will remember, you know, the early days of lolcats and sort of the cute furry cats and stuff that was the early sensations of the internet memes. Why does this happen? We have a natural desire for certain chemical prompts that occur in the brain. Certain endorphins that are triggered when we have eccentric thoughts, when we think about something that takes us into the realm of fantasy or conjecture. Different chemicals get swirled around in our brain, creative chemicals, possibility chemicals, and these can be positive feelings to endure. We go through these whenever we are forced to encounter something that is outside of our norm, and it could either be because it's threatening or it could be because it's exciting. And this is why we do things like go and watch action films at the cinema, or we go and watch horror films at the cinema, or suspense films at the cinema. It's because it triggers endorphins in our brain which causes us to respond in a certain way. We can have mini versions of that when we look at a website and watch some crazy thing happening. So social media, you could say in a sense that, well, it supplies that need. It provides a service to fulfill that need. But in terms of being a professional communication tool, well, what does social media really do for us? Now, there's some traps to think about when we look at social media. And as much as we talked before about emails being archived for, you know, forever, we're often not aware of the full extent of intellectual property rights that we give up when we contribute and participate in social media. Now, I think we are increasingly aware, we're becoming more and more aware, we know more about this all the time because it's getting talked about. But how many of us actually read in detail the terms and conditions of any particular social website before we put something up? Does that even matter to us? Would we care if what we were giving away was the rights to reuse what we've said or what we've posted by that organization anywhere at any time? Does that matter to us that we give that right up automatically when we do that? Are we simply accepting that as the current norm of online participation? Well, even if that's only sometimes true, what we need to be aware of is that that possibility means that we need to be more acutely aware of the longevity and the redistribution of anything we put up and our inability to do anything about that. We're learning more about privacy and security. But again, many of us would probably be a little bit surprised how little privacy and how little security we actually have. Security is a phenomenon, it's a bit like insurance. We often don't know that we need it until we lose it. So until you've had your identity stolen and your computer hacked and your passwords taken, we often don't feel that we're vulnerable. There's a certain sense of won't happen to me. And this is what those who pursue those kinds of things rely upon. But in social media, yes, there's been lots of changes in how we can keep things private, but privacy, there's still a myth associated with privacy, and that is that even something that we might have put in a social media context, and we might have said, well, only these people can access it, only my closest friends, or only my best friend, or only this person. Well, the truth is that that person has the power to universally redistribute what you've just given. Now, we might trust that they won't, but they still can. Or someone else who gets access to what they can see can redistribute. So the privacy really is a myth. It is absolutely unenforceable. Once it exists in a digital format somewhere else, it can go anywhere. So here's a more open question. Has anyone got a view on this? Social media. Is it a form of communication? Is it a form of expression? Is it a bit of both? Now, from a purely tool-oriented perspective, most of you would probably agree it's a bit of both. When you look at social media environments that we participate in, certainly these days, a lot of them have a chat function that you can chat to people who are also online. So it means that it's a tool of communication as well, but generally, we're communicating about the expression. So there is an argument to say that it's really more about expression, because any communication that tends to happen tends to be merely expanding on and elaborating on the emotional response to the expression that was made. So it's merely enhancing the expression. That's what it's really all about. Another debatable point. Eric's saying that he feels the social media appears to be mostly expression. And I think I would fall into that same camp in general. I think there's plenty of exceptions to that. I think when we're talking social media, it's a very broad brush. Of course, there are many different aspects of it. But I do think that in most contexts, there's a lot of expression involved in it. Bruce is saying it depends on the user. Could be kids talking about cats. It would be powerless. Would be for the powerless to have a platform. And I do think that you could use it you could probably say in both ways. It can be a communication and an expression. To communicate one's expression, I think there's certainly those who lack a voice or lack a sense of power through other means. Social media has given a lot of those communities, a lot of those groups, a lot of those individuals a voice that they otherwise wouldn't have had, a way in which they can be heard. And there's many aspects of what social media can do that's extremely powerful and extremely effective. And literally, you could talk for days about it. The key points that we're trying to pull out of this for ourselves is more about how is it relevant in a professional environment. Stephen's saying expression more than communication. People express themselves rather than have any expectation of a response. I mean, if you have a look at any of the major global news websites, and you know, I'm talking BBC, CNN, and any of the really large ones, there's a whole heap of them that you can have a look at. And look at those topics that have public posts activated, where people can post their comments. And if you read through those posts and you look at the degree of communication that goes on, and in my view, it's an enormous amount of expression. It's people expressing their opinions, expressing their views. And the downside with this is that every time we express anything, we describe ourselves, we describe our personality, we describe our views, and it's permanent. It's out there forever. And if we want to keep a separation between our professional views and our personal views, part of the problem with social media is that it makes that very difficult to maintain. David saying executes many agreements to do things with others via private messaging on Stalkbook. Stalkbook's another good name for them, I suppose. Here's another question. Is it a technology or is it a community? This is perhaps an easier question. I suspect that more of you will agree on this. Here's a comment from Simon Mainwaring. Now, Simon is an Australian chap. He is regarded as a bit of a branding expert. He's one of the founders of the We First capitalism movement. His view is that social media is not about technology, but it is about service to the community. Now, if we capture that portion and say service to the community. And we think, well, what is the vast majority of expression acting as a service to the community? It's just putting people, putting their views on display for others to then respond to as they wish. But really, in biophysical terms, it's about all those happy endorphins that we get, that get stimulated in our mind when we contemplate emotional context. Because emotions are merely, well, they're electrical storms within the brain that are created by disproportionate allocation of the chemicals in the brain. So an emotion is when certain parts of our mind have certain chemicals that make certain kinds of electrical current more prominent, more dominant. And this is why a lot of emotional disorders can be treated with drugs, because they are meant to control the way those chemicals function inside the brain. And this is why hallucinogens work. This is why various drugs that give you a certain high, it's how they work. So all of that is merely an accentuation of what happens naturally. So anything that causes an emotional response for us is something that can draw us in. But when you think about social media, there's been a few studies done that have talked about how do people change their response to something. When they log in to a community website, a social media website, the way in which they describe the feeling is very similar to stepping into a room. For a lot of people, it psychologically moves them into a different headspace. So they become, or they gain a feeling of connectedness to everything that is connected to that focal point, that social media point, in ways that would certainly not exist or don't happen when you talk about sending an email or even instant messaging. You mean instant messaging on various tools, etc. You don't have that same degree of connectedness, that immediate visibility to what everyone that's in your circles is doing or thinking about. Comment from Bruce saying, the manifestation of community through technology for a small group. I think it's a good point. These, as a technology, it's merely a facilitator. And as we sort of touched on before, it does facilitate the possibility for communities to be created. And these can be professional communities as well, which is the next point that I think is worth talking about, because media can be separated from its social context. Remember, we talked about the mostly emotional nourishment that most social media does for most of the human involvement. Professional media does something else. Now, LinkedIn. Most of us should be familiar with LinkedIn. Many of us would probably be using it. There was a question a little earlier that I hadn't got to, because it was asking about, I think it was asking about LinkedIn emails that we haven't picked up on. So LinkedIn is a professional tool meant to create connectivity between people for professional outcomes. Now, there's others. It's just an example of it. There's often groups that are created within professional circles, within professional environments. There's membership-based groups that if you're in a particular industry or you're in a particular function in a particular industry, you might have a professional media group that you're a part of. This can include things like professional blogs, where people talk about professional content. They don't talk about what they had for breakfast or what silly trick their cat did yesterday, but they will talk about something that's relevant in their industry, or they might raise a question, etc. It's the same technology, but it's being used in a very different way. One of the interesting challenges we have, because of the fact that the social aspect of this media became dominant before professional use of it became as dominant, and still isn't, we've begun our exposure to this world, and we've become used to it from a social perspective first. So we often see it as being social in nature before being anything else. But there's another aspect of this as well. When we use these kinds of things, what we're really doing is we're tapping into the social nature of our being. We are a social creature as humans. We are a community creature. We do tend to want to function in a community. We often take a sense of identity from that community. We take a sense of purpose and belonging from these sorts of things. And being part of professional media proactively or even passively fulfills a lot of those needs for involvement, participation, even identity. These can be very positive and very powerful things. But the same challenges apply that we talked about before. One of the things that we've got to keep in mind is that anything that goes on, whether it be social or professional or not, can and probably will have a professional relevance and impact on us. Most of us have probably encountered situations where human resources or people in positions where they are assessing our suitability in a professional capacity will be doing research on our presence online. They'll be checking to see what we've done, what our views were. There's increasingly more powerful ways in which that can be tracked and found out. And they might not judge us by the fact that we had drinks with some friends last week and went to a crazy party, but then again, depending on their profession, they might. It might be relevant. And if we posted some comment on some CNN website somewhere that expressed our political views about something, well, that's something that any professional decision-maker that wants to take that into account can take into account. Is it fair? Is it reasonable? Well, that's now up to them. We've left that in their hands. So here's a summary statement that tries to sort of wrap all this up and put a key point around it. Anything we say online, it's permanent. It could be there forever. We can't control how long it lasts, who stores it and where they store it. It's public. Even if we think it's private, even if it's gone to someone who we think won't redistribute it, something could happen. There's always the assumption has to be that it could go further than we intended. It's unretractable. You cannot claw it back. It's unpredictable. We cannot control what rights, even when we might have rights by law, it is very difficult to enforce those rights. And generally, when it comes to copyright and intellectual property, only the largest and most well-cashed organizations can afford to defend their intellectual properties. It does reflect on us because it's from us. It reflects on us every bit as much as anything we say in any medium. And we no longer own it because usually wherever we've put it has some rights to do something with it. Now, all of this can kind of sound a little bit scary, can sound a little bit negative, and perhaps in a sense it's meant to be. Online media should be considered professional media, every single bit, because every single bit can impact your professional perspective or how you are perceived professionally. It is all part of who you are because it's all part of how you communicate. And if someone wants to assess how you communicate, and if we accept any part of what we talked about before, about communications being fundamental life skill and expression of what we're capable of, then how we communicate in any medium is potentially relevant to the decision about how we will communicate in a new one. Eric's saying, it's interesting to see how technological choices affect communications. Facebook's requirement to use actual names arguably was a major factor in their longevity compared to other media such as MySpace. So, well, this is a good point, where they have a policy that says you have to be you. It's given this validity to what everything that gets sent, rather than using a persona or an avatar. Like, people that are active on Twitter have a number of different Twitter accounts that they use for various different things and can even use different personas. It's something to hide behind. Now, we all know that things that we see and hear about online, they might not be real, but they might be perceived as if they are. They might be judged as if they are. Peter's asking a question about new Australian privacy laws that have been introduced this year in the context of social media. What I'd ask Peter, that's probably a bigger question than we can cover in this discussion, and it's something that I'm not currently fully familiar with off the tip of my tongue. So throw that question up in the forum discussion and we'll get a few other thoughts and inputs on that, and I'll put my views on there as well. So if I could ask you, Peter, at some point in the next few days, do that, and we'll carry that discussion over there, because I do think it's worth having a discussion, certainly for all of you who are in Australia, it is worth going through that in a little more detail. So instant messaging. Where's all this taking us? Instant messaging. Well, if I was to describe one digital communications technology that I think has been most poorly used in its early stages, I would have to say it would be instant messaging. I think that it's a lot more effectively used now, and you know, I'm talking about a transition of only probably 2 or 3 years. But instant messaging is painfully brief. It can be painfully simplistic. It can be so lacking in context. We talked about email, where you know we typically write full sentences, and you know we might even spell them correctly. And we still struggle with too long and complex and confusing and poor language. Well, if those are the two biggest things, and when you add them up, they were close to 2/3 of the problem, and you're talking about a medium now that makes both of those things exceptionally harder, is it any wonder that we might struggle if we go even a little bit outside the bounds of what instant messaging is good for? Here's a phrase I like to talk about. Smartphones and dumb users. Not too long ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, I had a classic example of an SMS conversation that went horribly wrong. And yes, I tried many times to phone this person, and it was always not answering, not even didn't get a voicemail, just didn't, just user busy. So, and this was one of those classic conversations where I was asking where I should meet this person the next day. And I got back every different answer to every other question, and I kept repeating and asking, no, I just want to know where is it. I won't bore you with the details. But what tends to happen is that if you take what we talked about with email to the extreme, the degree of cognitive effort that we often apply to the nature of an instant message is about what we think is appropriate for a handful of characters on a screen. And we fall into the subconscious trap of thinking it was a tiny message, consumes a tiny amount of space. I'm going to give a tiny amount of thought to a tiny little reply. Now, if we do that as a habit, then we're functioning to the lowest common denominator, which is the tool itself. We're not taking responsibility for the nature of the communications and what it's going to do. Now, that's not to say that we should be putting elaborate communications via text messaging or via chat, but it means that it's once again all about the purpose. It's just about what is it going to do? What is the job that it's going to do for us? Now, instant messaging is fantastic at some very specific forms of communications and fairly horrible at pretty much everything else. Now, I witnessed once a commercial instant messaging system where everyone had a particular application on their desk that allowed them to message each other, typing text chat. And I watched these two people, and literally they could see each other and I could see both of them, and they were furiously typing at each other, having this enormous argument about something, I don't even know what it was at this point, but they were consumed for more than 40 minutes with an email that, well, not with an email, but with an instant message conversation that probably could have been resolved in 5. Or at least in 5 minutes, they would have covered significantly more ground towards a possible resolution than they would have, than they did cover in 40 minutes of typing. Now, many of you have probably seen that situation. Some of you have probably been in that situation. The trap, the mental trap, and the reason this happens is reciprocation factor. So when we see a message that pops up, we feel that we're immediately in a conversation of some, if we accept it, if we accept that message and we reply contextually, we put an answer in, we put some statement in that's in line with what's been presented to us, and we get a reply back, and we send a reply, and we get a reply back. We have become used to the fact that this is an accepted form of communications. It's not an accepted form of communications, it's an accepted form of messaging. So we're firing off these little self-contained little parcels of information, and sometimes they're not even that, sometimes it's just data. So we talked before about the role of email not actually conveying, not holding understanding within it, but trying to create understanding at the other end. Well, that same problem is compounded with instant communications and instant messaging. My rule, my belief, is that it should not ever be used for something you would consider to be a conversation. It should be used for creating a conversation. Bruce is saying that instant messaging is the perfect answer to annoying short emails to ask simple questions. Best part of it is you can have a bunch of them on the go at once. Well, yeah, that's a good point, Bruce. You can, in fact, have a bunch of them on the go at once. So that is certainly one of the features of instant messaging that makes it very useful. There'd be probably some debates as to how effective that sort of communication would be, but because you've got those few seconds lag because you're waiting for the other person to type, then it can be fairly efficient in some cases. But all the time that you spend typing, it's still potentially less efficient than if you'd had several phone calls one after the other or push the button and talk to them. I know it's hard to imagine us ever saying this not too long ago, but it is actually quite cumbersome to pick up a phone and push several buttons to communicate with someone. I mean, how painful is that? It's quite naturally a barrier to its use. Fortunately, that's being solved by the fact that a lot of these instant messaging programs have a button on them that says call. So switching to voice is often only one click away. So bottom line is, most instant messaging scenarios should be used as a trigger for something else. Now, I admit I use it in the way that Bruce has said as well. I get an email. I'm not clear on something. I send a quick instant message thing saying, look, or a quick answer. Yeah, I'll get it to you tomorrow. That sort of simple statement that's not meant to elaborate, as soon as it does go beyond the one or two simple statements, then you've got to question whether or not it should go somewhere, some other medium. Now, there's an accepted practice that in instant messaging that it's interruption-based, but you don't know whether or not that person is actually at their desk or not, or busy. And so we accept the fact that a reply could take some time. That actually makes it a very effective interruption tool because we feel comfortable with throwing it out there and waiting to see if and when they catch it and throw it back. Here's a very interesting quote from a somewhat well-known celebrity. Many of you would know who Kelly Osbourne is, a fairly well-known American celebrity, or at least has become well-known. Her dad is probably a lot more well-known. And she said, I was dating this guy and we would spend all day text messaging each other. And he thought that he could tell that he liked me more because he actually spelt the word Y-O-U, and I just put the letter U. What's this telling us? Well, it's telling us that people of the same culture, of the same generation, who are even in a relationship and presumably understand each other fairly well, can have such diverse perceptions on the intricacies of how instant messaging should work and the meaning behind it that they can extrapolate depths of relationship. Now, arguably, you could probably say that, you know, this guy would have taken anything to mean a disparity in the relationship. You know, we are, as human beings, inclined to do that. But it's the nature of instant messaging that it has become something that is so variable in its possible interpretations that it now falls into that category of something that's infinitely variable. Now, we're coming to the last stretch of our discussion, 20-odd minutes to go. I noticed that a few people, we've had lots of interesting chats and discussions. We're going to shift gears and talk about the user experience concept of digital communications. Before we do that, has anyone got any last-minute thoughts or questions I want to throw in about instant messaging or email or social media before we start to talk a little bit about the science behind the process? So what do we mean by user experience? Now, we have touched on some of this, so some of this will be an echo of what we might have already covered a little bit. User experience is essentially what the recipient or the user of any form of media goes through as a part of that experience, as a part of that interaction. So you have a user experience when you're interacting with a website or when you're interacting with any kind of blog or social media platform, when you're interacting on social media, even when you see and respond to an email. All of that is you are interacting and having a user experience. Now, we say that the user experience is the message, meaning that whatever we perceive that entire experience to be, all of that experience is going to contribute to our response and how we react to that message. Every part of it is going to be part of the structure or the construction that we make of the understanding and what we're going to do about it. So everything matters. This is why when we talked before, we talked about things like language matters, can create barriers. Tone, attitude, it matters. It can create barriers. The degree of confusion, how concise or conflicting that we might be in how we say things. All of the different little components work together. Because what we as a human being respond to is the sum total of our experience with that interaction. It's very much along the same lines as when you talk to someone face-to-face. You know, we all know that there's a great deal of body language that contributes below the line to the communications. And how we respond to that other person and to the message is often more driven by the body language than it is by what they've said. That's because that's the way the brain works. The brain looks to piece together the meaning from every morsel of its experience. And for the same reasons that our subconscious is tapping into all the body language, our subconscious is also tapping into the body language of whatever digital media that we're working with. So yes, it does mean that you can have a message that says one thing and a user experience that says something else. And in many cases, the user or the recipient will respond to the experience more than they'll respond to the message. It applies to everything that's digital media. So even software, you use software. We're all familiar and used to using software, and we do it subliminally now. We're not even aware, perhaps, of how much the experience. We might be aware of it when it's particularly problematic, when our frustration levels reach a certain point, and when it compounds and builds to a point where our frustration or the barriers to intuitive interaction reach a level that we notice. But the rest of the time, we don't. But each of these little barriers, they add up. They contribute to each other. So when we have our first little barrier or our first little misalignment between the user experience and the message, that first one we might not even notice, but they cumulatively compound. So by the time we have our perhaps the fifth aspect of what we're experiencing that's at odds with what we're meant to be experiencing, our frustration level is significantly more than the first one gave us. So they go up exponentially. But the full effect of whatever these incremental things are doing to us is usually not felt or not usually relevant until the end of that experience. But quite often it's the user or the recipient or the person at the other end that decides when the end occurs, because they decide at what point they tune out. They decide at what point they've seen enough, done enough, and they are distracted. But it's at that point that whatever accumulated motivation that our message or our experience has been able to create within them, that's when it takes effect. That's when they are either going to or not going to do something. And if you take the example of an email, a long-winded, confusing, problematic email, the reader will decide at what point they stop reading, at what point they think they know enough, and whatever decision they make as to what they're going to do about it will be made at that point. Up until then, we still have the opportunity to influence and have them react in a way that we want. But if we want via that email, if we want them to do something for us, they might not get to the end of the email before they've decided whether or not they will. So we do look at the vectors of change of how this works. And Emily's asking the question, are these the same vectors of change that we looked at in week one? And in 3C, yes, it is. What we're going to talk about in a moment is how to specifically use those three vectors in a communication sense. So we're going to not look at what they are, but how you would use them. So if we accept the principle that the entire experience surrounding any kind of interaction with digital communications, it can be defined, we can therefore predict what a person might feel and how they might react to something. We can therefore, to some extent, engineer that experience. We can actually create, just in the same way that we can control our body language. If we think about it, if we're careful about it, we can present our body language in a way that's conducive to what we're trying to say and the message we're trying to get across. We can do the same thing with any digital media. Sirab's just asking for an example of talking about instant messaging. We'll just go back to that point before we move forward. We'll use it in this context of the user experience. Example of using instant messaging as a trigger for something else. Well, the simplest example of that would be to send an instant message that says, I want to discuss XYZ. Are you free now or later? So imagine that sentence. Imagine if you'd got that popping up on your instant messaging thing on your desk. You've been given the context of my purpose. I want to discuss. Okay, so you know you're up for a conversation. I want to discuss XYZ. Well, now you know the context of what it is I'm going to discuss. That can align your headspace. So I've altered your intellectual vector. I've changed what you know because I've used an instant messaging to say, I want discussion about this topic. So the concept I've worked with is a discussion. The context is the particular subject, which XYZ, that I wanted to talk about. So I'm shaping your intellectual vectors. I'm changing what you know. I'm using the emotional vectors by working within your qualifications for urgency. I'm asking, can we do that now or later? What I'm suggesting is that I want it now. Now would suit me. Now is my preference because I've said that first. But later is acceptable. I've been non-specific about later because I know that the conversation isn't over. But I've empowered you as the recipient of that message to now give me a response that is specific about what later might mean to you. So I've empowered you to make a decision and guide my feedback. What I've done is I've given you a motivational reason to answer the question. I've prompted you to respond with an answer, now or later. As if that's all you do, then you've at least got that pressure to respond with a now or later. So let's say you respond with later, and that's all I get back. I now repeat my process and say, no problem, what time? So if I say what time, I'm not saying what date. I've narrowed it down to being clearly, I mean today. And maybe that's not clear. But I'm leaving that as a tacit knowledge. I've said what time. So that, again, empowers that. I've said that I still want this to happen at a particular time, but I'm empowering you, the other person, to nominate. And then I get a reply, 2:30. Great, I've got a time slot. Now what I can say is, great, thanks, I will call you at 2:30. What's that done? It's acknowledged their involvement in the correspondence, thanked them for making a commitment to me, and it's told them that I will initiate that second communication and that by giving me a time, they have tacitly agreed to participate in it. They have empowered me to initiate it. So it removes the possibility that they at 2:30 might not respond and then say, oh, look, I forgot, sorry. I'm going to call them at 2:30. Now, they could decide that they're just not going to be at their desk, but I've said that I will call them. I didn't say I'd instant message them at 2:30. And so if they don't reply on the instant message, I am empowered through that conversation to ring them on their phone, which they might still not answer, but I'm hoping. So there's an example of how in an instant messaging paradigm, I've specifically engineered a sequence by working through concept, context, content. And I've worked through the intellectual, emotional, and motivational vectors of change in a very short list of words to achieve an outcome, which hopefully at 2:30 will satisfy the full extent of what I need when I talk about it. Gareth saying, I've moved my WhatsApp messages across three phones and they're still all with me. Instant messaging sure is permanent if you want them to be. Yes, absolutely. Going back to that example about those two people that were having an argument for 40 minutes, I am pretty sure that they said stuff in their instant messaging that they would not have wanted to have been recorded if they'd been thinking about it clearly at the time. Bruce says, so much better than a pointless email. I agree. Let's look at our last slide. How do we use the vectors of change? What does it really mean? Let's drill down a little bit further and break it up a little bit. Let's look at the vectors of change, how we're going to actually shape a person's experience through digital communications based on where the challenges come from. What makes it hard? And what might we do about it? We've described this not as a silver bullet, but just the type of approach that we might have in solving or addressing these particular challenges. So we're talking about the intellectual vector. We're talking about what they know. So our challenge might be the fact that they don't understand. They are lacking understanding. It might be that they don't have a sufficient context. They don't know our context, or they might not be familiar with the context that we're trying to get across. They might not be aware of certain facts, certain prior knowledge that is kind of important to their ability to improve their understanding. Our approach to this might be to be more discursive in nature. It might be to test for understanding, find out where the gaps in their knowledge exist and fill it. That might have an educational component. We might need to deliberately and specifically fill the gaps in their awareness of facts and information, or fill gaps in their contextual understanding to help them shift their intellectual vector so that they know what they need to know. Or we might simply reference for them, let them know where they can find out more if we want to be passive about it. Give them the opportunity to broaden their own intellectual understanding or awareness. But what if our challenge is more in the emotional vector? It might come from the fact that they have an attitude, a habit of judgment, that it's pre-existing, based on pre-existing experiences that they are continuing to respond to, and they are applying a previous attitude or judgment to the current. Or what if we are interacting with some of their more poignant emotions? We might be playing with their hopes or raising their fears. The approach that we might use is to make what we're doing more personal, more relevant to them, making them more important. It's not so much about our message. When we're looking to shift the emotional position of somebody, it's about them. It's about what matters to them. And we have to give the understanding that what matters to them matters to us. So we make it a little more personal. We might need to listen. Sometimes the reason a person is clinging to a previous emotional state is simply because they haven't externalized it yet. They haven't processed it enough. It's still bottled up to some extent. And just allowing that externalization can be a way of lifting that emotion to make way for new emotions that we want them to feel. But also we might normalize it. We might simply accept and express the understanding that all these emotional things are just normal human behavior. Whether it's good or it's bad or it's what, it's just normal. We're not making a fuss over any emotional disposition. And when it comes to the motivational stuff, what if they know enough and they have the right emotional response, they feel, but they're just not doing? They're not motivated to act. Maybe they intended to do something else, a different intent of some kind. Maybe they don't have a sense of ownership. They have invested elsewhere, or they don't want to invest. They don't want to make an effort. The core element we need to look for is why. The approach we might take is encouragement. Encouragement that they are included, they are relevant, that their contribution, their action, their effort, whatever it is that they are expected or that we hope that they will do, it has value. It has meaning. It will matter to us, and therefore we hope it will matter to them. And because what they do matters to us, they matter to us. Now, admittedly, this is a fairly quick and simple discussion about what is, in fact, a fairly broad and diverse topic. But hopefully you can maybe pull out a couple of things out of this that add to and expand your own understanding of how you can very deliberately and explicitly tackle digital communications, about how we can't and we don't need to blame the medium. We don't need to think in terms of, well, it's only email or it's only this or it's only that. Usually, there is so much more that we can do with any form of digital communications or digital messaging or digital media. There is so much more that it's available to us. All we need to do is work with it. We need to think about it. We need to look at our purpose and work towards it. It's never going to be quite as good as a face-to-face conversation for many reasons, but it's still extremely useful and completely unavoidable in the modern world. So that's all we had planned to throw out there tonight. Has anyone got any comments, any thoughts, any summary ideas? Anyone want to throw any comments back that try to capture anything in a nutshell? Anyone got any feedback they want to say that they find any particular aspect of this discussion a little bit interesting? Just while you think about that, I'm going to tell you something we're going to do next week with our live webinar. What we're going to trial, we want to trial running for you a chat screen that's visible to all of you and is something for all of you to chat your way through. So we're going to try and do that. I'm not sure how successful it's going to be. So I'm going to put that disclaimer in this waiver, but I want to tell you about it because I want you to sort of think about it and hopefully get a little bit excited about the opportunity to chat in real time with each other through all of this. It's still separate from the questions box, so if you want to talk or have anything raised for us or for me to talk about in the discussion, that's still something you'd put in the questions box. So we're going to try and do that and yet still have that separate spot for you can see what each other's saying through the conversation. So we'll see how that goes. All right, is there any last-minute comments? Let me just ask, was there any other... No, doesn't appear to be. Here's one from Peter. Don't understand the vectors of change very much. Listen to the pre-recordings, wait for the post-recording. Peter, do have a listen to 3C. It's probably going to give you the most detailed... approach to what these vectors of change. I mean, it's a complex phrase, a vector. It's just simply saying that we change in response to what we experience in three different ways: our mind, our heart, and our motivations. Mark's just saying Microsoft Link is becoming more common and conversations are saved in Outlook. Microsoft's working very hard at what they can do with making Link quite pervasive. I think they've got a lot of I've got a long way to go with what I could do. I think it's just starting to scratch the surface. But I think it's an example of one of those tools that is certainly trying to become more pervasive. But it's just a tool. It's just one of those things that it's worth us keeping track of what it can do for us. But it's worth also making sure that we keep in mind that it's only going to do what we ask it to do. It can't do any more than that. And it can certainly do a lot less than what we ask it to do. Peter's just commenting on things like SharePoint, Confluence, other collaboration systems that might be relevant. Look, I think that's all very true. These are digital mediums that create connection points between people. You know, they create points of overlap and interconnection. They therefore form a kind of communications medium. I think, you know, once you start talking about all those sorts of things, you could probably go on for quite some time and covering all of them. I think they're all quite relevant. I think there's some commonalities with how we approach it, and this whole idea of the user experience and the vectors of change is meant to be that sort of common thread, because these are the laws that apply whether you're talking about email or instant messaging or Facebook or SharePoint, or no matter what it is, these laws and principles will still apply. So, you know, hopefully that's part of the common denominator, if you like. Lorraine's just asking, do you have any documents of the pre-recordings? Do you mean a text-based transcript, Lorraine? Is that what you are you asking about? The short answer is no. This complex version of that answer is we would like to. So no, we haven't done that yet. I guess that's a technology barrier for us. I mean, we're still working out what would be an effective way of converting the audio directly into effective text without too much work. So we have been looking into that. We haven't found a good answer yet. So unfortunately, it's audio only. Alyssa's saying that it was excellent. Brilliant. Thank you. It was great to see that you enjoyed it. All right, we've gone 3 minutes over. We'll wrap it up at this point. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. It was great to see so many people logged in once again. We will look forward to catching up with you again next week. Next week is the last week, remembering that we are going to give you just that little bit extra content next week regarding written persuasion. And we're going to try to do some interesting things online with webinar as well. Until then, thanks very much for tuning in. And from me, for now, goodbye.